Good morning and welcome to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. I am located at 1563 Main Street in Peckville, Pennsylvania, and I am right here each and every week at this time on this station to bring you, the Pennsylvania landowner, the information that you need regarding natural gas development. At the Clark Law Firm, I represent landowners, oil and gas right owners. I do not, I have not, and of course, I will not ever represent gas or pipeline companies. I represent the landowner. For such things as gas lease, pipeline negotiations, water lines, royalty and royalty deduction issues, claims against gas or pipeline companies, whether they be royalty claims, unitization claims, any and all claims related to natural gas development, again, whether against a pipeline or gas company, any type of dispute, surface use agreements, any and all contracts related to natural gas development, you name it, related to natural gas, that's what I do. So if you're in need of representation, give the office a call anytime to see if we can help you. 570-307-0702. That's 570-307-0702. Love to hear from you. And as I've been talking about lately, just real quick, another review and consultation. I do a lot of reviews and consultations with people who are located throughout Pennsylvania, but in other parts of the country, and even sometimes the world as well. Just recently, over the last 6 weeks, did a review and consultation for a client who lived pretty far out west, we'll say in the Wyoming state area, but had property in Pennsylvania. Called, we did a review and consultation, took about an hour. Based on that, they said, hey, we'd like you to do some other things for us. Took another couple hours. The end result was a significantly better lease with significantly better royalty calculation language, which I believe will result in hundreds of thousands of more dollars over the life of the lease. I really believe that. It also resulted in a substantial piece of property getting a final lease agreement that precluded any and all surface rights, meaning the company cannot do anything on the surface of the property. And these guys were about to sign. They said, hey, you know what? Let's do a review and consultation. We did it. And within a month, they've signed a significantly, significantly better agreement. And how did that all occur? Because they said, hey, we're not going to just sign. We're going to get some information to make sure that we're protecting ourselves and we're not leaving anything on the table. And I am so glad that they called, because the second I picked up the file to do the review and consultation, I knew that I was going to be able to help these guys significantly. And I knew it wasn't going to take a lot of time. So those are the things that do occur, and they occur, to be honest, quite frequently. And that's the thing. Don't be afraid to pick up the phone and call. See if we can help you. See if I can help you. And if I can't, you call, you don't like the feel, you don't like the sound of what you hear, hey, that's okay. You just made a call, that's okay. Or maybe we can fast forward and you ended up getting a great benefit as a result of whether it be a review and consultation or other representation. So I really want to hear from you, regardless of where you're located. Do not let distance scare you. I have so many clients that I've represented in the western part of Pennsylvania, currently do, sure I will continue, and have represented for years. And again, clients who are located physically throughout the country, but the property is located in Pennsylvania. So I really want to encourage you, pick up the phone, give us a call, see what we can do, and see if I can help you. See if I'm right for you. Give us a call. 570-307-0702. And I'm going to get into today, I'm going to talk about what's called a production allocation agreement. That's what it's called by Chesapeake. Cabot is doing the same type of thing, and they call it a multi-unit well, and they seek consent, C-O-N-S-E-N-T, consent from the landowner to drill what they call multi-unit wells. Chesapeake is seeking to enter into an agreement, a document, which I have in front of me here today, called a production allocation agreement. Well, hopefully if you listen to the show, you know that our golden rule should be stop signing documents. Get assistance, whether it's from me or somebody else who knows what they're doing, get assistance. Get somebody working for you to educate, inform, and help you, not somebody working for the gas company. I know I sound like a broken record, but there's a reason. Too many people are only getting the information that the company wants to provide them. That's the information that they get. They don't get their own information. They don't get assistance from anyone working for them whose total goal is to help them. No, they listen to the gas company representative, the landman, the employee, whatever it may be. And what are you going to hear if that's what you're listening to? Are you going to hear the information that you really need to know from somebody working and fighting and giving effort for you? Or are you going to hear information from the person who works for the company that they're going to provide you information that they want you to know, that the company wants you to know? Are they going to tell you, hey, look, you have a lot of leverage here, and here's some things that you can do? I just had recently, totally true story, roughing the numbers a bit, pipeline offer, client offered $80,000. Meet with the company. I meet with the company. These are prior clients, so they know, hey, we get this offer. Call Doug Clark, see what we can do. We look at it. We do our initial consultation, get a plan together, and then we move forward to implement the plan. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you join me each and every week at this time on this station. You can always call the office 570-307-0702. So, okay, quick story. Clients who have represented them before for leasing and pipeline, get another pipeline agreement, call me. The initial offer is around $80,000. Within one meeting with the gas company, or I'm sorry, the pipeline company, they agreed to go up to about $120,000. Within 30 days, the agreement is now in excess of $300,000. And I'm not getting specific on numbers. It is in excess of $300,000. Oh, and the terms and the language and the property protection are all significantly increased as well. Now, does that happen every single time? No. Does it happen, you know, somewhat often or commonly? Well, again, that's, I guess, kind of a gray area, but it happens way more than what you think. And the key is to understand the market, the company, your leverage, all of the different factors that come into play for your specific situation. There are times where do a review and consultation. I say, hey, look, your lease allows this certain type of activity. This is a pad or a pipeline, for example, that's going directly to a pad. Maybe it's on your property. So we are very limited on the leverage that we have. So here's what I think reasonably you can do. And I would recommend that you try to do this and then just get out of town. You can go ahead and sign the agreement, but we want to improve it. And the worst thing that ever happens is that you know now what your leverage is, what you could do, and you make the right decision. The best thing that can happen is your agreement can go from something like $80,000 to $300,000+, and you can get a ton better terms, a lot more property protections, a lot more limitations. And there have been times where pipeline agreements have gone from $20,000 to $200,000. I could go on and on and on in these. The key is stop signing, put the pen down, call and find out what can you do. What is your leverage? Can you negotiate? How aggressively do you want to be? All of these things are things that I address in these initial reviews and consultations. And again, if you decide that you don't go further, which is more than fine, you now understand the agreement, you understand your position, you understand your leverage, and you are informed in what you need to know in going forward by somebody working for you, not somebody working for the company. How we can, as landowners, rely on the statements made by the company land man who works for the company and not you, the landowner, by the company employee, by the company representative, and make our decisions based solely on what we're told by the other side in an adversarial relationship and negotiating a contract. You are now relying on the other side and only getting the information that they want to tell you, that they want you to have. And guys, that just doesn't make sense. So I found that these reviews and consultations, which most of them I do by telephone, but I do many in office too, that they usually only take 1 to 2 hours. And usually that includes my review time and prep time to get ready for the review and consultation. I have found time and time again these to be such a valuable tool for people in deciding then how they want to go forward. And I mean how they want to go forward with that negotiation. How they want to go forward. Do they want me to do anything further? Do they want to have me just in the background that if they need me in the future, hey, I'm here. I'm here to help you and do whatever I can do. But that review and consultation, people, we shouldn't be hesitant to take advantage of that service. And I think sometimes think, oh, well, you know, there's a distance here and, you know, oh, lawyers and they're expensive. Give us a call, learn about the service and see if we can help you. Time and time and time again, these reviews and consultations have worked so well for our clients, so well. And that's why I talk about them so much. They're very valuable to people. Love doing them. And I tell you time and time again at the end of the calls, the client says, wow, thanks so much. This was really informative. Because the radio show, you know, is never meant for specific advice for anybody. But it's general information. Get you thinking of things that you should be thinking about, understanding kind of some of the tactics, or some people may say tricks, of gas or pipeline companies, why you need to be getting assistance, whether it's from me, Attorney Doug Clark, or somebody else, why we should be doing this. Reviews, consultations, and representation that I do is specific to you. So we look at your situation and use all the experience and history that I have to give you the best advice that I can. And remember, I have negotiated, reviewed, and consulted on pipeline agreements, as an example, with over 70 different companies. That gives you an idea of the experience there. So when you're relying on the company landman, company representative, company employee to tell you what you think you need to know on a pipeline agreement, is that what you should be doing? Or should you be relying on somebody, whether it be me, who've negotiated these agreements with dozens upon dozens and dozens and dozens of companies, or do you want to rely on the company who's out there to negotiate the best deal for them? Just think about it. And again, look, if you don't call me, and I mean this, if you don't call me, call somebody. But too many people are signing at $80,000 when $300,000 would be available. Too many people are signing at $20,000 when $50,000 are available. Too many people are agreeing to unlimited pipelines when you could limit them to one pipeline in many cases. You have to know what you can do, and you have to do it the best you can. And if you don't care about yourself, care about your kids and your grandkids and so on in your property. But you got to do the best you can do. And we're here to help you. And keep listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. I'm here each and every week at this time on this station. Give us a call. See if we can help you. See if I can help you. I do all these reviews and consultations myself, nobody else. 570-307-0702. When I get back, I'm going to talk about these multi-unit wells, these multi-unit well consent requests, and this is new, guys, that Chesapeake is now starting to send out production allocation agreements. Production allocation agreements. Important documents, important contracts, major commercial contracts. We're going to talk about them. I'll be right back after this break. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you tune in each and every week at this time on this station where I bring you, the landowner, the information that you need regarding natural gas development. And as always, I have not, I do not, and I will never, not ever, represent gas or pipeline companies. Ever. will I ever do that? I can't say it enough, because I am here for the Pennsylvania landowner. And I'll tell you a quick, this is just yet another example. Client has a gas lease that says, and I had nothing to do with this original negotiation. I wish I did, but it stated that for each well that was drilled on the property, they would get $2,000 per year for the well. And it turns out that I believe it's 7 wells drilled on the property. So that's $14,000 per year. But yet, somehow, the company goes out to the landowner, who's an older gentleman, and he ends up signing a document where he obtains a one-time lump sum. Can't say how much, but let me just say, not really high. One-time lump sum instead of $2,000 per year. For if you had 7 wells, that would be $14,000 a year. 10 years, that's $140,000. And so the person signed something where I can only guess that they sure as heck didn't understand what was going on. They didn't call anybody. They didn't get assistance. It was an older individual. And now they're missing out on these annual payments in place of a lump sum payment, which would have been exceeded very, very quickly, very quickly. So again, we have to stop this. We have to stop being taken advantage of. The company, their responsibility is to do the best they can for them. We need to accept and understand that. And that is not a problem. That is not a problem. They are out to do the best they can for themselves. They are out to do the best they can for themselves. That's okay. They are not out to do the best they can for you. That's okay too. Think about it. Are they there to do the best they can for them or for you? They're there to do the best they can for them. So what do we need to do? We need to know that, understand that, recognize it. Perhaps most of us, many of us, have experienced already that the company is out to do the best that they can for themselves, which again is okay. That's natural. What's not natural is where we are allowed to believe, or we let ourselves believe, that the company is there to help us, that that's their goal, is to help. How can we help you? How can we help you? My opinion, absolutely, sometimes what benefits you is going to benefit the company. Absolutely. That's absolutely going to happen. However, many, 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 many other times, what benefits the company, such as royalty with deductions, royalty calculation methods that allow for affiliated sales and index pricing, all of these different loopholes and hidden things in contracts that you're never going to identify or understand if you've never experienced it, and sure as heck, the company isn't going to tell you about these loopholes that are going to allow them to calculate royalties or pay royalties in a way that's very advantageous to them, not so much for you. So again, we got to understand that, and we have to defend against that. And how do we do that? Well, we do a review and consultation. We get representation. We find out what's going on here. You don't have to sign up for a year representation. Do a review and consultation. But get the information that you need for your circumstance by someone working for you. Sorry, it's a bit commercial, but it's just, things come up during these weeks that get me all fired up. And I say, how in the world did this person sign this contract? How could they have possibly signed it? And how they did is because they never got any help. They never got any assistance. They were under the belief that what was occurring was in their best interest because they were told how great this was going to be for them. But then looking back, wow, they may have made a big mistake. We can't go backwards in time. Boy, I'd love to, but we can't. So what we need to do is make sure we're protecting ourselves today for the future, for the future. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you tune in each and every week at this time for All Things Marcellus and give us a call. Learn about reviews, consultations, what we do. I do gas lease negotiations, pipeline agreements, any type of claims against the gas company, unitization, royalty issues, any and all contracts, getting more involved in some of this litigation stuff. So if you have any complaints, claims, any type of negotiation, any contract for review, consultation, give us a call, 570-307-0702. Okay, I want to talk about these production allocation agreements. That's what Chesapeake calls them, and what Cabot calls them are multi-unit wells, and they seek multi-unit well consent agreements. Now, let me start off and say that this can get very, very technical. And so, again, I can't express enough that the specific advice for everybody, if you are presented with a multi-unit well consent from Cabot, if you are presented with a production allocation agreement from Chesapeake or any similar document by any company, get assistance from somebody working for you. Whether it's me or somebody else, get assistance. These are powerful legal contracts. And the Chesapeake document, now let me say, just because I say one is more concerning or maybe one is worse or one gives me more pause and hesitation doesn't mean that there's not problems with both documents. I don't care which it is. You need, in my opinion, and this is the strongest opinion that I have, you need to get personal assistance. I do these reviews and consultations with these types of agreements, and they usually take an hour, sometimes up to two, but not that long because we're not reinventing the wheel. I've looked at these documents dozens and dozens and dozens of times, and you're seeing them for the first time, and they are complicated. And again, you're going to be presented with this document, and then you're going to get called or visited by the company, land, man, or employee. And then they're going to explain what this document is and why you should sign it. Who is going to explain that to you? The company employee, the company representative. It's a complicated document, and it changes. It changes, especially Chesapeake, how your lease operates. So you need to get assistance from somebody who's actually working for you to make sure that what? You have the information that you need to know from your side, not the information the company wants you to know. Oh, hey, you're going to make a bunch of money. This is great for you. This will be less pads. This will be less trucks, less pipelines. Here, sign here, sign here, sign here. Oh, well, what about does this impact my lease? Wait, sign here, sign here, sign here. We need to make sure you understand what you're signing because, in my opinion, these are big deals presented as though they're not, but they are big deals. And if you listen to the show, hopefully you know better. We're not going to just sign. We're putting a pen down, we're getting assistance, and we're making sure we're going to do what's right for us and our situation. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you join me each and every week at this time on this station. Also, call the office 570-307-0702. So, okay, talking about these production allocation agreements or multi-unit well consent documents. So let me try to explain this in general, what these documents are, or the purpose of these documents, what they're trying to do. So what's happening is the companies are able to drill today longer horizontal wells than they used to be able to drill based on technology advancements and improvements. Now, let's also remember that technology isn't going to stop improving as of today. So whatever you're agreeing to today, you need to keep in mind how in the future, maybe drilling techniques change and what you've agreed to may allow something that you haven't even ever contemplated before. And so what do we do in those cases? Well, we try to limit what you're going to agree to so that we defend against unforeseen consequences. That's what we want to do. How do we do it? We limit the consent or the agreement that we are granting. So companies want to drill very, very long wells. Now I'm going to make up some numbers to make this kind of easier to follow. let's pretend that, and please know that these are total made up numbers to illustrate this example, how this works. Let's pretend that a horizontal well that is 5,000 feet long covers a production unit, let's say it's 600 acres in size. Again, making these up. So if the well is 5,000 feet long, it covers a unit area of 600 acres. Well, what the company wants to do is, instead of only drilling 5,000 feet and covering a 600 acre unit, maybe they want to drill another 5,000 feet for a total of 10,000 and cover, instead of just a 600 acre unit, they would cover a 1,200 acre area. But they don't want to make one giant 1,200 acre unit. They want to keep two smaller units. In my example, we'll say each unit is 600 acres in size. So what they want to do is they start drilling and they drill out horizontally 5,000 feet. And instead of stopping there, they continue on another 5,000 feet. And so now you have a well that is 10,000 feet long. And in my example, it is now going through 1,200 acres of units, but these units are divided into two 600 acre units. So instead of one well covering one big unit of 1,200 acres, what they're looking to do in many cases is drill a longer well, but that well will go through more than one unit. The first unit in my example would be 600 acres. Let's pretend the second unit's another 600 acres, but that well may continue even further. For example, maybe instead of stopping at 10,000 feet, that well goes on another 4,000 feet for a total of 14,000 feet long. So again, just roughing it out, the first unit that this 14,000 foot long well would go through, we'll say is 600 acres. Then the next unit that it would go through, in my example, is about another 600 acres. And the last unit, since it's 14,000 feet, we'll pretend that that unit's maybe about 500 acres. So now you have one well that's going through three different units. And the idea is that instead of the company creating one massive, large unit, they're going to have one single well go through a series of smaller units. And the good news, and the company wants to preach to, which is understandable, again, that's okay, we understand. The good news is as you drill these longer wells from one pad site, you wouldn't need as many pad sites because you have one well going out 14, 15,000 feet. And so you're covering a much larger area, close to a 3-mile area from one pad site, again, in my example. So that is a benefit. And of course, that's what they're going to preach to you, the landowner. And as a general rule, we do want to minimize surface activity. We always do. So that is a benefit to the landowner. But of course, it's a major benefit to the company. They do not need to construct multiple well sites. They can reduce the number of well sites that they have because instead of having a well site that it can only have lateral wells or horizontal wells that go out 5,000 or 6,000 feet and then have to have another well site and then go on and on and on, what they can do is have one well site and go out, say again, example, 15,000 feet in the north and northeast and southwestern directions. They can do that, and it limits the number of well sites they need. They need less well sites. So again, that can be a good thing. So that's something they're really going to point to. But let's not forget that the company is getting a big benefit as well. The company is getting a big benefit as well. They can save a lot of money by not drilling all of the, by not constructing all of these different well sites. It also is more cost effective for the company to drill longer wells because they don't have to go, they don't have to drill a bunch of vertical shafts and then go out to 5,000 feet from three different wells. They go down once, say 5,000, 10,000 feet straight down, and then they go out horizontally. And so now their cost of drilling is much less because they can drill one well that goes down and out 15,000 feet instead of constructing multiple pads and having to drill multiple wells that go down 10 to 15,000 feet and then go out 5,000. Now they just have to go down one time, 5, 10, 15,000 feet, and they can go out 15,000, 20,000 feet and cover a lot more area. So it's very beneficial to them. We can't forget that. So we need to make sure that, hey, if you're getting a benefit, what can we do? What type of benefit may we be able to get from our side? And that's, though, I can't stress enough, that's only part of the equation, because there's other information in this document. And there's some, in my opinion, this Chesapeake document, information that is just, to me, just terrifying. And we need to address it and understand it. And if you address it and you understand it and you say, hey, I don't care, then that's okay. You're making an informed, intelligent decision. But if you're just signing a document, and I'm going to tell you, this document is very complicated. It is very complex. And so if you're just signing this, or you're just signing it based upon what the landman or the company employee is telling you, my opinion, you're making a terrible mistake. Terrible mistake. I'm going to get into the document after this break. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Give us a call anytime, 570-307-0702. 570-307-0702. I'll be right back after this break. And make sure you join me each and every week at this time out on this station for All Things Marcellus. I'll be right back. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you join me each and every week at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus and the information that you need regarding natural gas development here in Pennsylvania. Not the information the company wants you to have, but the information that you need. Okay, so talking about production allocation agreements, and I want to stress too, I'm focusing on Chesapeake's production allocation agreement today. I've done another show in the past, maybe a couple, on Cabot's multi-unit well consent agreements. So either one, my strong advice is get specific advice. I do these reviews and consultations all the time. You can call us 570-307-0702. I am only able to scratch the surface of these agreements in today's show, but I'm going to highlight some things. Again, the purpose of the show is to get you thinking, to understand why you need to be thinking about these things and why you should be protecting yourself and getting advice from somebody and counsel from somebody who's working for you and trying to help you, not trying to help the company. So we talk about these agreements are set up to allow the company to drill really long horizontal wells to cover a very large area. First and foremost, that may not be in your best interest. It may be, but it may not be. And a big part, the initial evaluation, is to determine where you fit in this process. Is this a good thing for you in general or not? What are the good things? What are the bad things? Do you need to sign? Are you able to negotiate for more money? Are you able to negotiate for royalty? Maybe, maybe not, but you need to be looking at all of these things. If you have the well pad on your property and you are presented with one of these agreements and you are signing it without calling me or somebody, I prefer you call me because I do a lot of these and I really think we can help you. 570-307-0702. And I say that because I really believe it. You need to be getting specific advice. You, in my opinion, should be getting additional compensation for this. You're going to have more activity. Your lease may last longer. You're going to have more truck traffic. All of these things you need to be aware of, and you need to make sure that you're being compensated appropriately for it, and you're not entering into an agreement that is wide open that can haunt you and your family for the next decade upon decade upon decade. So again, it's one of these examples. If you have a pad on your property, you really need to be making sure that you're handling this the correct way. But that doesn't mean it's not the same for everybody. because the people with the pad on the property have more leverage, more negotiation power. But that doesn't mean that you don't have negotiation leverage as well. You just may not have as much, and there may be different things that you do. Or you may say, hey, look, I don't want to sign it, when you understand what's going on and what your rights are. But you're not going to get that from the company who is representing their interest and only giving you the information that they want you to know, not the information that you need from your own side. So, okay, you're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm, right here each and every week at this time on this station. So I want to talk about, this comes from the production allocation agreement offered to a landowner, in this case, Sullivan County, Pennsylvania, and this is from Chesapeake and its partners. So in this case, I'm going to again paraphrase because there's too much to get through in one show, but just to give some flavor of this type of agreement. Number one, it says, paragraph number one, production from each allocation well shall be allocated to the unit on the basis of the allocation factor. It's a pretty complicated sentence already. The initial allocation shall be based on the unit designation in the declaration and notice of pooled unit most recently recorded to the drilling of the allocation well. If your head isn't spinning, it should be. The parties acknowledge and agree that operator may amend or revise the unit at any time and in any manner. In operator's discretion, not yours, operator's discretion, if it is reasonably prudent to do so. So if in operator's discretion, it is reasonably prudent to do so. In this event, production from the allocation well will be allocated based on the revised unit. Now I'm going to tell you. This goes on, and I don't want to bore you to death because you'll never be able to follow this, but I'll just go quickly. We'll have some fun. The allocation factor, this is continuing, next sentence. The allocation factor shall be a fraction, the numerator of which is equal to the length of that portion of the production drain hole length that lies within the unit, and the denominator is equal to the productive drain hole length. For the purpose of this agreement, the productive drain hole length of an allocation well is defined as that portion of the horizontal length of the wellbore path that begins at the point of first take, or at the first take point, excuse me, and runs along the wellbore path to the last take point. In the event an allocation well shall be developed with more than one horizontal drain hole, the allocation factor of the production drain hole length shall be calculated separately for each horizontal drain hole. Oh, it goes on. For the purposes hereof, take point shall mean any point along a horizontal drain hole where oil, gas, and or condensate could enter the wellbore from the production interval and be produced. Guys, I know, I just was having some fun there. But the point is, my heavens, I mean, go ahead, go to the website, pagasleaseattorney.com, pipelineattorney.com. Today's show will be posted there tomorrow morning. You can go back and you can listen to what I just read time and time again. And I'll tell you, God bless you if you can understand it. And so I can tell you this, that because I see this and we study this and we deal with these, I can explain these things on an individual basis. But this just gives you an idea. That, ladies and gentlemen, is paragraph one. That is only paragraph one. That gives you an idea of, holy heck, somebody can talk circles around people. When they're handing them this document, it is very, very complicated. And when you're seeing this for the first time, it's very, very complicated. And then you take a complicated document. Again, that's one paragraph. This is only one paragraph. You take a document like this and you put it into the hands of a company employee, representative, or landman who works for the company, not you, the landowner. And you give it to them and you say, hey, go out there. We want to have you have people sign this document. Most people are not going to understand what paragraph one means. Again, there's many other paragraphs. So it's very easy when you have a one-sided debate, a one-sided discussion, to tell the people who you're talking with only what they want you to, only what you want them to know. And so I have a lot of fear that people are signing documents like this and really having no idea what I just read meant. And frankly, it's probably most people. And that's okay. This is complicated stuff. And that's why we need to make sure that we're protecting ourselves. And I know I sound like a commercial at times, but it's so true. These are opportunities, in many cases, opportunities of a lifetime. These are opportunities affecting the wealth of your family, potentially for generations. These are opportunities that are going to impact your property, again, for generations, potentially. We need to get this right. And look at the history and look at how many people, thousands and thousands, 10,000 plus, that don't feel that they got it right when we're talking about gas leasing. How do we make the same mistakes? We don't. We get the information, we become informed, and the information is available now. It's not like 2007, 2006, 5, and even 2008 when people didn't know what they were doing and the information wasn't there. Now we have a body of information. The learning curve, we're climbing it. And now we can go into these negotiations informed and understand and make sure we're doing the best we can. And we're not going to just simply sign and return documents. We're going to know what they mean. And we're going to get advice and we're going to get counsel from someone who's there to help us. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. You can call me 570-307-0702. And if you get these agreements, I really hope you do. Love to redo a review consultation, offer you advice and say, okay, what do we do? Let's get a plan together. And that's what we're here for. So, okay, I want to go to paragraph number two. I'm not going to go through all of these because I don't have time, but paragraph number two, extremely disturbing to me, and it should be to you. Number two says that the production from the operations on or for each allocation well shall be treated as if they were actual operations on or production from each of the leases, meaning that whenever they start to drill a well at the origin point, at the pad point, even if your property is 3,000, or I'm sorry, even if it's 15,000 feet away or further away, if this well was going to your unit, well, that well's deemed to be drilled as if it were drilled on your property for lease purposes. That can be very, very, very important. And one client where, had they not signed an agreement to allow multi-unit wells, which they didn't because they did a review and consultation, had they signed it, their lease would have been held and they would have received royalties on 12.5% with full deductions from their royalties. However, we did a review and consultation. We identified the fact that if they didn't sign, their lease was going to expire within a few months. And we knew the market at the current time was $1,000 an acre and 15% royalty, and we knew we could get royalty without deductions that was going to be extremely strong, and favorable to the landowner, way better than their original lease. So hypothetically, if they owned 100 acres, they just made $100,000 by not signing, and they now have a lease that has 15% royalty with no deductions versus a lease of 12.5% royalty with full deductions. Translates into hundreds of thousands of dollars of increased value over the life of the lease, and certainly could be over $1 million. And it all started, thankfully, with a review and consultation and saying, hey, wait, I'm so glad you called. Here's the deal. By signing this, it's probably going to mean that your old lease, which is about to expire, will stay in effect. You'll get no more bonus. You'll get 12.5 royalty with full deductions, or don't sign. Wait until your lease expires in 2 or 3 months, and then you should be able to enter into a new lease, which we ultimately did, and you can do it at 15% without deductions. Oh, by the way, you can pick up $1,000 per acre. That originated in the phone call. That started with a phone call, and that's what I'm talking about. I'm not telling you that's going to happen in every phone call. Absolutely not. But I'm telling you, it doesn't happen just once, that these type of things happen all the time. There are other times we say, hey, look, here's the situation. You don't have a lot of leverage here. Here's what's going on. It's a short discussion. We identify what you can do and formulate a plan as to what can be done. And you know that you're not missing out on the opportunity and you're fully informed. That's the worst thing that can happen. That's the worst thing that happens when you do a review and consultation. And you can call, learn about it, 570-307-0702. And keep listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. We're going to keep bringing you this news because you have to have it. I'll be right back after this break. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. I'm going to jump into it. I got a short segment and a lot to cover. So let's have at it. Continuing on to this production allocation agreement, again, get thinking about these things, please. Goes on to state that in paragraph 2, that the operator, listen to this, this is crazy. The operator will have reasonable use of the surface and subsurface of the lands covered by the leases to conduct operations for exploration, drilling, production, operating, transporting, and marketing of oil and natural gas and its constituent elements from one or more of the allocation wells. And each individual interest owner hereby grants, bargains, and conveys a subsurface easement and such other rights to operator and the lessee group, meaning the other gas companies, as may be necessary or convenient for the exploration, drilling, production, and operation of one or more allocation wells. We're not done. Including, but not limited to, rights for laying, maintaining, and replacing pipelines, roads, and constructing and maintaining production facilities to produce, store, treat, gather, and transport oil and or gas from one or more allocation wells. That's paragraph, this is the rest of paragraph 2. So you are now granting all of these surface rights. You are granting all of these surface rights in this production allocation agreement, regardless of what's in your lease, regardless of what you've done to negotiate, to improve your lease, to limit surface rights, to give at least mutual consent, at least consultation. No, you're granting them all of these surface rights. Oh, and by the way, so you understand, you're granting them all of these surface rights and that these provisions, in case of a conflict between these provisions in this document and your gas lease and essentially any other document you've signed where there's a conflict, here you go, paragraph 6. The provisions of the lease or leases, division orders, transfer orders, pooling, operating, or other agreements covering the affected lands, meaning your property, or leases within the unit are hereby amended to the extent necessary to make such instruments and agreements conform to the provisions herein. So you are amending your oil and gas lease. You may be providing surface rights that didn't otherwise exist and many other rights that may not otherwise existed. And you're going to just simply sign this document. You can't do that, in my opinion. I mean, you can, but my heavens, why would you? This is an oil and gas lease amendment. It says it right here. Oh, and when you do this, and if you listen to anything, if you are signing ratifications and amendments without getting assistance, without understanding it and getting legal help, you are making, in my opinion, a potential enormous mistake. It is the trend where you may have a lease that expired. The company may have breached it. You may have arguments to say that your lease is no longer in existence. You may have the ability to negotiate or challenge the lease, but you sign a ratification of your lease or an amendment, and now you're stuck. You just fixed everything for the company to your detriment. Now, again, Not every time, but this is occurring, and this is something that's driving me personally out of my mind. We have to stop signing amendments and ratifications to these leases without getting help to understand why is this occurring. And I have personally seen multiple amendments and ratifications. The hidden meaning behind this is the company has a problem. They're not going to tell you what that problem is, but they have a problem. And by you signing a ratification of your existing lease or an amendment and ratification, you fix that problem. We need to stop that. We need to stop that because you may be able to negotiate a new lease. You really may be able to totally do a new lease. And here, of course, the company throws in the next sentence. In addition, after paragraph 6, in addition to the foregoing, meaning all the other stuff, which I didn't read everything, each of the undersigned interest owners, meaning you who signed this, do hereby, all capitals, guys, ratify, adopt, and confirm. Now, regular text, that the lease or leases under which your owner's interest is devised or derived, and you grant, so you're ratifying, adopting, and confirming the lease, which you already have. And what you're saying is, you're essentially, in my opinion, resetting this lease. That you're saying, hey, this is all valid. Everything you've done is good so far. And I'll tell you this, Western Pennsylvania, this happens all the time. Western Pennsylvania, people are signing these ratifications and they're ratifying leases and amending leases that the company, in a lot of cases, could never produce under. And probably giving up a tremendous opportunity. Tioga County alert. You should not be signing amendments and ratifications without getting assistance. If you are in a position where you are held by a vertical well, and there are many people, my last count, 175 wells that SWEPI has in regulatory inactive status. Vertical wells just holding your property. If you're in that position, I want to hear from you. We are investigating this and we're looking into this and we're going to try to do something about it. Because I know when you signed a lease that you didn't think that they were going to drill a vertical hole, cap it, sit on it for the next 5 or 10 years and not do anything with it. That wasn't what you were told. That wasn't what you anticipated. That wasn't what you reasonably believed. So if you're in that position where you have a vertical well that's holding you and nothing else, especially if you've been shut in for many years, at least 4, 5, 6 years, I really want to hear from you and hear your story and see if there's a claim in your case. Because my opinion, this ain't right. This ain't right. And that's what we're here to stop. We need to make sure that people are being treated fairly and not being stamped on and run over because we're uninformed and we didn't understand what we were doing. We need to make sure that we stop that. Stop it today. We need to make sure we stop it. And again, look, we can't go back in time, but what we can do is we make sure in the future that we don't repeat the same mistakes that maybe we have made or other people have made. Again, the advice is get specific advice. But there's a lot of things out there that I have problems with. And one of the biggest is when you're holding thousands of acres and individuals of hundreds of acres by merely drilling a vertical well that you probably will never even produce from. And you're just holding those, making annual shut-in payments. When years ago, people said, when they came to the kitchen table, talking about how rich they were going to be, oh, we don't shut in wells, we don't do this and that, we want to drill, we want to get your royalties, here's my pen. Well, now we're seeing what the reality is. And then there's a question, can you do this, company? And I assure you, I want nothing more to bring a legitimate claim to say, this has to stop. So that's why I want to hear from people. Give us a call. We'll do an intake and see if it's something that maybe we can help you with. 570-307-0702. And we're talking mostly Tioga County, SWEPI. You know who you are. We want to hear from you. 570-307-0702. We got to try to stop this. We really, really do. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Unfortunately, we're out of time for today, but remember, today's show will be up on pagasleaseattorney.com and pipelineattorney.com tomorrow. Also, remember, stop signing bad agreements. Get good advice. The landman works for the company, not you, the landowner. My number, 570-307-0702. Have a great, great week, everyone. See you next week.